I'm in Peru trying to understand the purpose behind the Nazca lines, and my guide has just shown me a big piece of the puzzle.
Judge, this is what I wanted to show you. Look at that sign.
Oh my God, that is incredible. It's huge.
This is what we call the candelabra. Huh?
Candelabra.
Candelabra.
The candelabra glyph can be seen from 12 miles out to sea. It was made by the Paracas people.
How old is it?
It's about 2,200 years old. The Paracas didn't know candelabras. It was borrowed by the Spanish.
Sure.
But this could be a cactus.
A cactus.
The big branch, the big column in the middle, if you elongate that column, it is linking to the hummingbird of Nazca line.
Really?
Which that one represents the beginning of the rainy season there in Nazca.
They point to the same direction?
Same direction, exactly.
Wow, that's incredible. It all comes down to water.
Yes, exactly.
Hearing that the Paracas candelabra is aligned to the Nazca hummingbird bolsters the theory that the shapes are tied to water. One historian who believes he can prove that has a bold new theory about the lines. Back on shore and a few miles inland, I'm meeting with the director of the Paracas History Museum, Brian Forrester.
Brian, I hear you're the man to talk to about the Paracas people.
Well, I guess I'm one of them, but sure, I'll take the job.
Quickly learning that to understand the Nazca, you gotta understand the Paracas.
It's essential.
Okay, so how do I do that?
Well, I've got a couple of special places I want to show you.
All right. 4x4?
No.
Why not?
Sand.
More sand.
Yeah.
Brian is taking me deep into Paracas territory. Where exactly, I'm not sure. But I'm anxious to see what he has in store. The Paracas thrived in one of the most inhospitable deserts on Earth. And ultimately, they died here too.
Is that bone?
Yeah. This is a recently dug up grave of someone at least 500, maybe 1,000, maybe even 2,000 years old.
Brian has led me to a massive Paracas cemetery, a necropolis that's a mile wide and 5 miles long.
Rough estimate, how many people do you think are buried here?
I would say at minimum 10,000.
Unbelievable.
But this site is completely unattended and at the mercy of any looter with enough gas to get out here. Many of the graves have been totally destroyed.
These trenches that I see along the way here, those are looted graves?
Yes.
And underneath here, still preserved burials as well, I assume.
Oh, many, many more. This is someone's skull.
Unbelievable. That is incredible. I'm looking face to face at a Paracan, probably.
Yeah.
I've never had the experience before of stopping in a place and picking up a human skull out of the ground.
We carefully return the skull to the ground and recover it with sand.
After hundreds of years of being in peace, put them back in a state of peace like that.
Back on the ATVs, we head deeper into the desert. Brian has researched the glyphs and lines in the area and calculated that a number of the lines intersect at a location several miles to the east. I'm anxious to find out why. As we round the bend, a buried Paracas temple looms before us.
Wow!
Much like the Nazca Temple of Cahuachi, this Paracan pyramid was a gathering place for religious ceremonies.
That's incredible.
Yeah.
Just unexcavated.
Yeah.
Trapped in the dunes.
Yeah.
A pyramid. How many of these do you think there are here?
In this area, there are hundreds. The foundation of it, at least, would be 2,000 plus years old. The Paracas were the first established culture of this area. So the Paracas were responsible for at least 50% of the geoglyphs and lines, and then the Nazca, the second 50%.
When you look at the Nazca lines, when you look at the glyphs and the geometric shapes and the Paracas shapes, mm-hmm. What do you think they're for?
There's no real cohesion or basic pattern. I think some of them are for solar and lunar alignment. Some of them are ceremonial pathways. Some of them are for tracking underground water systems.
This is a bombshell. Brian believes that not only were the lines used for ceremonial purposes to pray for water, but that many of them may actually lead to water, a sort of physical map overlaying underground rivers and pointing to natural wells.
You think there's ancient water sources here?
It's possible that slightly under the ground of that area, we can find water, today.
Looking for water in the desert?
Yep.
Sounds like a challenge. Go.
The lines that led us to this pyramid likely guided the Paracas on ceremonial processions, but might also have functioned as directions to water.
What do we think these depressions are?
It could actually be accesses, like little wells for water.
Really?
Yeah.
So you're saying that there may be water under this?
Well, I'm saying it's possible, yeah.
Well, let's give it a whirl. Let's see if there's anything here.
Okay.
Brian's theory strikes me as impossible, mostly because this is an absolutely lifeless desert. But he's convinced, so I've got little choice but to start digging.
This is a ridiculous way to spend an afternoon.
Update, I'm parched, I'm sweating, and it's 8,000 degrees out. The more we dig, the more I feel like the only thing I'm going to find beneath the sand is sand.
How far down do you think it really is?
I wouldn't think even 10 feet below.
Really?
Yeah, well, we're hitting a lot of roots.
Yeah, that's a good sign.
These roots are dead, and if Brian and I don't get back to the road before dark, we might be too. But if there is an underground stream here, we might also answer the riddle of the Nazca lines.
I can't help but notice that I'm down in the pit shoveling and you're supervising.
Well, I'm a local.
Right.
It's your right as a visitor to explore.
I appreciate you letting me do that.
Well, my honor.
Soil's getting harder.
Yeah. Whoa. Oh, wait.
Look at that. Wet soil.
Yeah, you've hit the water table.
Water. There is water down here. In the desert.
Yeah.
This discovery at the convergence of these lines is compelling evidence that the prehistoric tribes of Peru might have carved their massive symbols to track water.
That is so cool. Amazing. You know what? I don't want to say that I doubted you, but I really doubted you.
Thanks for the hard work.
This is incredible. It really may be that the shapes in the Nazca lines do point to water.
Some of them at least, yeah.
Yeah, that's incredible. Yeah. It's hard to argue with that. Wet soil, right here.
As we leave the sand-choked ruins of the Paracas civilization and head back to Nazca, there are other clues that may back this theory up. With just an inch of rain a year, the Nazca became masters of water management. Some of the lines, including the newly discovered lines, depict strange spiral shapes. And on the edge of town, there are similarly shaped holes that actually serve a very real purpose.
So these are called ojos. It's basically a very elaborate looking manhole. It's a check well that goes down to an underground aqueduct system. This is the very bottom of the system. And what's so cool about this is there's no cement lining this, there's no concrete here. This is just naturally piled rocks, and they're using the natural sediment of the floor here to allow this water to just pass through. It doesn't absorb, it just passes like an underground river.
These wells led to tiny underground streams that flow down from the Andes. 2,000 years ago, the Nazca figured out how to tap into them, and it's so well built that it still works.
It's a little cold. You can see that down here. This system is working exactly as it did 1,500 years ago, providing clean, drinkable water to the Nazca people.